Hey everyone, it's Dominic the Primetime Treasure Hunter. Thanks for coming by to check out another video. We are just a few weeks away until a new year, a new decade. 2020 is soon upon us. And what I like to do at the end of every year is sit back and reflect on the prior year. What went right? What went wrong? How do I build off of the successes and improve upon the areas where I made mistakes? And I don't only have a year of mistakes to look back on, I have 20 years of mistakes to look back on, reflect on, and share with you in this video. I'm going to go over 20 mistakes made over the course of 20 years of reselling. Some of these are mistakes that I made a long time ago and I don't make them anymore. Some of them are new mistakes and some of them are mistakes that I continue to make and try to reduce over time. So hopefully sharing these mistakes with you can be helpful, especially if you're new. But even if you're a seasoned veteran, I still think that given that there's 20 things to go over, that you're going to find something in here that's hopefully useful. And as usual, feel free to share your comments and tips down below in the comment section. So just so I'm clear, before I get into the 20 mistakes on what I'm referring to with this 20 year time frame, I have often mentioned in other videos that I started with eBay in the year 2000. Now that is technically not really true in the sense that my eBay account that I currently use did start in 2000. But as I think back and reflect on it more, my wife and I, Mrs. Primetime, moved down to South Florida in 1998, September of 1998. Now, we weren't married at the time. We got married a few years later. But as I mentioned many times before, to help support myself financially while I was going to graduate school, we would go over the course of the weekend to this big giant place called the Swap Shop. I've never shown it before. Here's a picture of it here, that whole big area in blue in the Fort Lauderdale area. Go stop by if you ever go down there. It's a great place. Most of it is outdoors, but there's an indoor component as well. It's a great place to learn. We got a lot of great stuff there, found a lot of treasures, but we also made a lot of mistakes because remember back then there was no eBay app where you could check comps. But it was a great place to learn and that sort of thing. So we were doing that for about 4 years, selling on eBay. So I was selling on a different account in that 1998-1999 time frame. So that's why I would say it technically goes back to, but my current account did start in 2000. And then from there, I was reselling sporadically here and there while I was going through, additional training. There was like postdoctoral work and stuff. And, starting my career. And then once I got into mid-level with my career and felt I had accomplished, enough stuff there, I started getting more intent and intense into the reselling again, and more intense on a level that I was even doing back then in 1999, that 2000 range. And so for the last few years, it's really, really been hardcore, but I just wanted to clarify what I meant from that 20 year time frame, because it's not, I don't want to pass it off as if it's been 20 years of nonstop intense reselling, but there's still a 20 year time period to go back and reflect upon. So I'm going to start off with the first one, and then we'll just go through each of these. They're not really in any particular order, but the first one I'm going to share with you is one that actually happened recently. It was either earlier this month or later last month. And it's the one that actually bothers me the most, because over the course of this 20-year time frame, I have never, ever lost an item. And I was very proud of that. And so my first mistake that I'm going to share with you is losing an item, but also I'm going to work in here something that has happened more often, which is difficulty finding an item after you have sold it. And so let's just start with the item that I lost. This is actually it. This is the item that I lost. And one of the things that bothers me the most about it is that it's a comic book. And that's, the comics are, as you know from watching my channel, is something that I specialize in. So you would think I would not lose something like that. But there's two reasons why this happened, why I lost it, that I'll share with you. Number one, I made the mistake of keeping this book next to four other Star Trek books that look exactly like this one. I mean, it's not the same cover, but very similar in terms of the coloring and even the thickness of the book. You can see it's a 100-pager, and the other ones were similar in that vein. So I kept them together. I sold the lot of four separately from this one, and I knew at the time when I kept them together in the comic box that they, you know, they obviously would be separate orders, but I told myself, nah, I'm not going to make this mistake in terms of ever lumping them together to someone, because I normally double check things. I double check the count before I send things out. But that day I may have been in a rush or something like that, you know, to get out of the house and try to pack something up real quick. So I sold the four, I grabbed them, I put them together, and I must have accidentally included this one with the rest of them. So part of it was actually overconfidence. I had never made the mistake before, and I just didn't think I would make it again. And so that made me be a little careless with this in terms of not doing what I should have done, which is to find a way to keep this separate from the other one. So instead of just keeping them back to back, I could have put, for example, a divider between them. That would have prevented it. Or I could have done something a little bit more extreme, which is just to take this one out and put it in a completely different area and separate it out that way. But it's very important to make sure you're doing that double check on all items. And if you have not ever lost an item before, don't make the mistake that I did in terms of being overconfident with it. You know, it's going to happen eventually if you are not double checking and being super careful. Now, I've lumped together with this one. I could break it out, but I've lumped it together in terms of having difficulty finding items that you have sold. That has happened to me many times. I'd say it's happening about the rate of one time every couple of months. But when it does happen, it's a real pain. There have been times where I'm searching for things up to an hour. Usually these are things that have been listed for a while, and then I can't remember originally where I kept it. Now, ways I have been trying to reduce this problem, and I am going to make sure this is fully implemented in 2020, is to have an area where you only have the items that you have listed. That is your area where, you know, the only things you keep there are that, nothing else, nothing else that you may want to list at some point. It is just reserved for that specific function. And right now I do have an area where most of the stuff that I have listed, it's located in that area. It's a shelving system, but I still do have some items on there that I actually need to list. So it's not absolute yet, but I am working on that as you know, we speak pretty much. I mean, that is something that is going on currently, and I fully expect to have that system in place, totally in 2020. So that's just another suggestion in terms of having a specific processing center just for things that you're going to ship out. So that's number one. Let's move on to number two, which is not completely understanding shipping. And I distinctly remember, especially when I got, you know, more intense into reselling a few years ago, going over to the post office and having a conversation with the manager in person and saying, listen, I don't understand how people are making any profit with reselling, because the prices that you're charging here in the store for the postage is absolutely insane. It's crazy. And so we started talking more about making sure you're printing out your labels online through eBay, and also just me being more aware of the different options that are available that sometimes you're not even going to find in the store. A perfect example of that would be the padded flat rate shipping envelope, which at the time that I made my most popular video on my channel about this, which has 54,000 views, that cost $6.90 to ship out. Well, I spent about a year putting items in there that were shipping out by weight and by geographical location, and I was not getting the flat rate discount at the time. And you get the maximal discount if you're top rated seller. Right now it's $7.33 at the time of making this video. It's going to cost more if you're not top rated, but that's an additional way to get discounts that I wasn't fully aware of at the time. So becoming knowledgeable about areas that are weaknesses for you and turning them into strengths are things that I would suggest. So what I did, I started watching as many shipping videos as I could, reading up as much as shipping as possible, and then I turned that into a strength, whereas now I feel like I have a competitive advantage with regards to shipping. And we're going to talk about other shipping tips and shipping mistakes during this video that have helped me out that don't only deal with USPS, for example. But It's a big area. It's a complicated area. It's one that a lot of new resellers struggle with in particular. So I have a playlist, especially if you're new, go to it. It's all on shipping and I give all sorts of shipping tips. And if you look, the top two videos that I have are shipping related and they're related to the padded flat rate envelope, even putting things in boxes into a padded flat rate to get that shipping discount. There's lots of ways that you can get discounts in your shipping and make it make sense for you. You just have to be knowledgeable about all of the different ins and outs through USPS and other places in terms of how to get shipping discounts. So that would be number two, not having complete knowledge and wasting money by not having that knowledge in shipping. So number three would be boxing an item and not realizing that you left out a small piece. And I have done this before with remote controls and wires from like DVD players like this. I've never sent it out that way, but I have had times where I'm then wasting time reopening the package to put in the piece that I forgot to pack in there. And so it's very common with remote controls. What I used to do is I would pack up the remote control first, put that to the side, and, you know, maybe, you know, pack up the wire or something like that, and then pack up the main unit, put the unit in the box, and then tape it up and forget that I had the remote control to the side. So what I do now is I actually keep the remote control in the bottom of the box after I pack that up first, because it's easy to just put some bubble wrap around it. And then now there's no way that I will miss it and forget it. So keep all the contents in the box from the beginning. Don't even take the stuff out. If you're going to take it out, make sure you have it in full view. Don't just like put it to the side somewhere, because inevitably, you know, something gets put on top of it and you may forget it. You may even ship it out and not realize that you left the remote out, which should be a real big pain in the neck for your buyer once they get it. So that would be mistake number three. You know, it's just a big time waster and you want to make sure you're cutting down on anything that wastes time. Number three, and this is a mistake that I know I don't share in this one. A lot of people have made this error, but this is one, this is my most recent one. I'll show you how I protected myself a little bit, but still a mistake, which is sometimes choosing to auction an item versus sticking with buy it now, best offer, or just buy it now. In general, my suggestion has long been that auctions should be reserved for items that you either just want to get rid of, you don't care, you're just trying to get something back, break even, just get rid of some stuff, or items that are high in demand and are low in supply. Now, I only met part of the criteria with this one, which was this is the costumes that you, this is one of the six costumes that you may remember me purchasing recently at the comic book convention. This is the GoBots one. Now, the other ones were all Photon laser tag related. So I got six costumes for $40. So, and here's this one here too. And it's the Psy-Kill character, which I have experience with selling the toy in the past and have done really well with that toy. People go crazy whenever that toy comes up for sale. So between that and also it just being GoBots, I know there's a lot of GoBots fans, plus me just doing some research and seeing that there have been a lot of GoBots toys that have sold really, really well at auction. Now, this is not technically, it's a toy, it's a costume and a mask. It's collectible though, it's in the original box, it's in amazing condition. So all those things considered, I felt like taking a risk on this one with the auction could have been a good idea, because I have done very well in auction formats and have made more money in the auction compared to what I would have made putting it up as buy now. I would have never thought some items, for example, would have sold for what they have sold for in auction format. That's happened this year. That's happened in many years in the past. So with this one, my logic was, well, let's just try it in auction format. We'll see what happens. If in worst case scenario, it doesn't do well, I know it'll sell for something. In this case, you could see it only sold for $15 and got three bids. And that's with me promoting it like crazy. You may have seen me put it on my Instagram account. I put it into a GoBots Facebook group, a costume group. I mean, I had it all over the place. It had plenty of views, you know. So the problem with this, it didn't have the demand. That's the thing that killed me with it. And I didn't have a comp on a costume with the man. I had a comp with something similar, and sometimes that will work. So similar would be toys, but it's not exactly the same thing. So you gotta be careful. So what I could have done on this to mitigate this mistake even further is that I could have started the opening bid higher. So I could have started, let's say, $30 or $40. That could have worked. The con in doing that is that you decrease the chance that you're going to get a nice buzz around your item, and a little frenzy could sometimes develop where you put that up for $9.99, for example, and you usually, you know, could tell you get a bid within 24 hours, which I did in this case, but just didn't build from there. But a lot of times, you know, that could really work. Or what you could do is put it up for buy it now first at a really, really high price. So let's say $150, something that you know, may not think it would sell for, but maybe it could get up to that crazy number through, you know, an auction that people get into, like a bidding war over something. And just keep it there. And then if you get a lot of questions on it and people wanting to make you offers, then you know you have like a ton of interest on it and you could put it up for auction. That's an approach that Craigslist Hunter uses and suggests, and he's done very well with it. So, you know, that's something that I have used before. So I suggest being conservative. So if this was the only costume that I had, if I had only purchased this one, I would not have taken the risk on it. The only reason I took the risk in this instance is because I knew I had the other five to fall back on. And ironically, even though the Photon costume is not as popular as the GoBots one, it's not as popular as a brand. You know, people know GoBots, they don't really know Photon that well. This one sold within a few hours after I listed it for $42.50, took a best offer. So I have made my money back from my original investment, and the next four costumes sets that I sell are going to be where my profit comes in. But nonetheless, looking back, this still was a mistake. I debated it back and forth with Mrs. Primetime. What should I do? And I went with the auction, and I shouldn't have done it. I should have went with the buy now best offer on this one. But, you know, like they say in business, sometimes you do have to take risks. Sometimes they're going to pay off. Sometimes they're not going to. But I do suggest being, again, conservative with the auctions. So the next one, and this is a shipping tip one, is not shipping items. So this is number five. This is not double boxing fragile items. Now, this could apply to glass pieces. It could apply to anything that's fragile. But I will tell you, in my experience, the mistake that I have had has to do with not double boxing ceramic pieces. I would think I have the item packed up perfectly because I had layers and layers of thick bubble wrap around it. I even would put some cardboard around it, air cushioning, even some little styrofoam pieces, things like that, you know, packing peanuts, whatever. But invariably, I would still come across situations where the buyer would receive my item and there would be chips in it, or it would be broken or shattered. And so I had to figure out a way to prevent this from happening. Now, there's really only two ways to maximize the chance you could prevent it. One is if you have the original box it came in with the original styrofoam that may have went around the piece so that there's literally no chance that it can move. That's in a sense almost like double boxing it. But if you don't have that, by double boxing, what that means is, just like it says, you've got to take the item, pack it properly, still put the bubble wrap around it in a box, and then take that box and put it within another box. That's what I do now. And since I started doing that, I don't have any problems with my ceramic pieces breaking. So I would highly, highly suggest double boxing your ceramic pieces. It's a mistake that I have made several times. And like I said, eventually the double boxing is what wound up solving the problem. Number six, this is a mistake I made for a long, long time, which was not enrolling in the global shipping program sooner. And the reason why is because I heard so much negativity about it from a lot of people. And, you know, in the beginning, when the global shipping program first started out, there were problems with it. Like any program that first starts out, you know, there's glitches and there's things that go wrong and all that sort of thing. But over time, it really did improve. And I was convinced from talking to enough people that I respect that use it, that it was worth trying it. And so I am so glad that I did. I have two videos on it, which you could check out if you want a full review. I reviewed it initially, then 3.5 months later. That was about a year ago. And I could tell you right now that a year after that one, I still have had no problems with it. And it's given me a ton of sales by broadening out my marketplace from just the United States to other countries. Yes, there's other ways you could ship internationally. You could choose to just ship internationally yourself if you want to and have the buyer pay for it. You could do that through USPS. You could do it to, there's other places. Like you could do it through Pirate Ship, for example. So there's other ways to do it, but I think your maximal seller protection is going to come through the global shipping program. So I highly suggest it. You ship it out to Kentucky, and they will then take it, process the package, and they will charge the buyer for the cost of sending the item to whatever country it is that they live in. So all you have to do is worry about getting it to Kentucky. That's it. You could choose to cover that cost if you want to, or you could charge the buyer to get it out to Kentucky, however you want to set up your business model with the shipping. But again, I would highly suggest it. You are going to make more sales pretty much guaranteed by having the global shipping program available as an option, simply because you are broadening your marketplace. So number seven would be letting my box situation get completely out of control. And you could see here, I did two videos on this. The first video thumbnail, you could see in more detail just how much the box clutter was just out of control. What I had to do to solve the problem, which I talk more about in the second video that you'll see below, where everything is just neatly stacked and it says how to organize your shipping materials and prevent total chaos, is eventually, I know there's some of you watching this right now who are dealing with a lot of box clutter, you have to break up some of those boxes. And you have to stack them on a shelf, stack them somewhere so that you don't have every single box being ones that are nested within one another. You can do that with some of them. I still have some here that are nested just to have some prepared because it's just easier when something sells. But the vast majority of the boxes now are all broken down. In the past, the vast majority of the boxes that I had were all nested within one another. And it was just got crazy, got out of control. I had too many boxes. Some I just had to throw out. There was no need to keep them. They just weren't viable boxes anymore. So just make sure that you try to keep your box clutter under control, because it's going to lead to a stressful situation. And the more stress you're under, the more difficult it is to think clearly. And you need to think clearly, you know, to function effectively in your reselling business. So having a clean environment to work with is very important. So that's something that I am, continuing to make sure that I keep up on, and I am. So that's something to pass on to you as well. Number eight would be letting my hand off of an item when I'm at a sale. Now, this is typically a problem when you're at an estate sale. It could sometimes happen at a garage sale. You could see my hand on the item there. That's from a recent video. A few years ago, even though I talk about not making this mistake, I did make this mistake a few years ago, even in a situation where you wouldn't expect it to happen. And that's kind of one of the things I want to pass on. So first of all, just in general, especially when you're at an estate sale, if you have an item you're interested in, like this Skeletor toy right here, if you put it down, it is now fair game for anyone to grab. Doesn't matter if you're looking it up on your phone and you could show someone, it is fair game for someone else to grab. You have to keep the item in your hand. This is why I bring a box with me as well, is so I'll put items in my box. There's a lot of things I want to look at, keep it in there. This way no one else can grab it and I could process the items that way. But a few years ago, just to show you how crazy this could be, I was in a basement at an estate sale and I was in a cubby area in the basement. There was no one else in the room. So this is typically a problem you have to be real careful of if there's other people around you. But there was no one else in the room at the time. There's a coffee can unique to Syracuse that I'm looking at. I take it off of the shelf. I say, wow, this is pretty cool. I'm gonna check this one out. I put it back on the shelf. I start looking it up. Another person comes in the room, peeks their head in, sees the coffee canister, grabs the coffee canister off, and just walks right out with it. And I'm standing there like, what the heck just happened? To this day, I'm still mad about losing that coffee canister piece. And I have not taken my hand off of an item since when I'm interested in it, whether there's anyone else in the room or not. That's just a tip. You never know. Even if you think you're alone, that no one else is going to come in and possibly get it, still keep your hand on it or keep it in a box, because somebody else could come in and swipe it from right under your nose. All right. Number nine, this has to deal with big, bulky items like this one, like this multi-disc laser disc player that I sold recently. I mean, this thing is huge, right? So a lot of people shy away from something like this because they say, well, you know, this is going to be way too expensive to ship. And you're right. If you were to ship it through USPS, especially if it's going far. So my tip here and the mistake is I was not using FedEx for the longest time. I was just sticking with USPS. Big mistake, especially more nowadays. I'm glad I transitioned over to it, about a year or two ago, because without it, I would have just continued to waste money. So FedEx has much more reasonable rates for big, large, bulky items, especially ones that are going a far distance. So for example, New York to California or New York to Washington or something like this. Like this item would have cost about $60 to ship with USPS, something around that range, like $50. And it wound up only costing like $15 to ship it. I can't remember where it was, from New York to far away, somewhere on the West Coast, and just wound up just saving so much money. So you've got to check FedEx, either Smart Post or Home Delivery. Those are the two options for the big bulky items where you'll get a nice discount over USPS. There are a lot of people who just focus on something like USPS because that's, you know, what they think is the, you know, that's the place where they should ship things through. But it might be nearby you or something like that. Maybe you have to drive an extra 5 minutes to get to the FedEx. It's worth it. Make the trip. You can make a lot of money in reselling if you know the best place to ship it. So remember, when I find an item like this and I source it, I'm already thinking worst case scenario, what if it ships to California? How could I make this ship out at the most reasonable cost? It's FedEx. I was recently talking to Fella Flips on, as another reseller on Instagram, and he was talking to me about an item that he had shipped out, and it cost about $50 to ship it. And I said, well, how'd you ship it out? He said, USPS. I said, that's why you're losing money on the shipping. I said, you've got to check FedEx. He goes, why didn't I ever check FedEx before? I cannot believe I never thought of that. And he went and he checked the rates. He's like, I cannot believe this. I'm going to use FedEx from now on. So I know there's other people out there watching this who are in this situation. Please, please, please check FedEx. You will save a ton of money, usually about half the price on average of USPS, and it will usually get there very close to the same time as Priority if you could choose the home delivery option. If you're going Smart Post, it's going to take a little longer. Make sure also, I've talked about this before, for big bulky items that you are checking off for your shipping, that it's going to go out general economy 1 to 10 days. If you don't see that option, I did a video on it. You could call eBay to make sure you get that option enabled, because then once you pick that and a buyer sees that, you could then choose whatever rate is the best one for you. Even sometimes Priority could sometimes wind up being the best rate depending on the size of the item and where it's going, but it gives you the maximal flexibility. Remember, if you check something off Priority, you can't then go ship it off economy. But if you check it off economy, you could ship it off Priority if that's a better rate. No one's going to complain about getting their item faster. They will complain about getting it slower. So that's that one. The next one related to different shipping service would be besides FedEx, would be Pirate Ship. I did not use Pirate Ship for a while after I was informed about it. Noel Griffiths, Farm Girl Scavenger, was telling me about it, and I just didn't get around to it for a while. I'm generally cautious about things that are new, and so I'm very worried about getting caught up in anything that's sometimes kind of trendy and maybe even be a scam associated with it. And so I really like to do my research about these things first. And so I did that with Pirate Ship and eventually decided to switch over. There were enough people that I trusted who were using it, and my own reviews of it showed that it was completely legit. It is integrated with the post office and with eBay. Basically what happens where you're going to maximize your discount here is through using their cubic rate shipping item. So this, it's an ideal service for small items that are heavy. So things that are over, even over a pound, but small, heavy items. So what I mean by small technically is going to be anything that fits in a box that is less than 19 inches. So 18 inches or less. that's the biggest dimension that you could have is 18 inches. So as long as you fit that criteria, you are eligible for cubic rate shipping, in which you are going to be charged for the size of the box. Basically, you're not going to be charged for the weight of the item and how far it goes. So that's a big difference from what you're going to pay priority. So sometimes you could wind up spending under $10 for something that's going to cost you well into the double digits on USPS if you're using Pirate Ship's cubic rate. There's also discounts available through their box in the bag program as long as you meet the criteria and the specifications for that. So make sure you're checking out both of those. But Pirate Ship, I highly recommend. Set up an account real easy. It integrates in seconds with your eBay account and totally legitimate to you. So that is 10. I could have just stopped there, but we've got 20 years, so we've got 20 more mistakes. And so me not using this was another mistake. I lost a lot of money doing this. I lost a lot of money with the not using the FedEx. There's lots of things I've lost money with over time. I'm not losing the money anymore, and I don't want you to either. But there's going to be some other things as well. Sometimes it's losing money. Sometimes it's losing time. And something I lost a lot of time, and time is money, is with how I was printing out my labels. Last year I changed around, and again, I heard for a long time, invest in a thermal printer, and I didn't. It costs about $170 to make the investment, but it's worth it because the thermal printer works by printing based off of heat technology. It does not use ink. So you're gonna make your money back just by not wasting money on ink or, you know, toner cartridges over time. Plus, it's nice and compact, as you'll be able to see here in the background here for the Rollo. That's what I recommend. You could also use a Dymo, but what I was doing was printing them out in a regular printer that used ink, either myself going upstairs getting the label, cutting it out, or getting my kids to get the label for me, cutting it out, taping it on. It just took so long. I actually compare the time that it took in this video versus printing it out on the Rollo. So here's me. I'll show you right here a little clip of me pressing the button, and you'll see how quick the label comes out. Watch this. That's it. Really quick. Check this out. This is awesome. Look at that. Looks like it. There you go. Really easy. Prints out. That is a self-stick label. So you just peel it off. You can put it right there. No need to get off of your comfortable couch. You can bring a whole bunch of packages over there at once and just, you know, print out label after label and put it out. Or if you like to do like all your labels at once, you could just have them all processed in bulk and they will all just come streaming out of there. You don't have to do them one by one. You could just bulk print the labels off of there and they just come out in seconds. It's crazy. So thermal printer, I highly recommend it. If you want to go to this video to see my review, why you need to have a thermal label printer, you could search for that on my YouTube channel. And I have a link to the Rollo there if you want to buy one. I have an affiliate link there that helps support the channel if you're interested in that. And thanks to those of you, I know many of you have watched that video and have bought a thermal through there and have been happy. And I thank you for those of you who did use the link. So thermal printer, not using that was a big mistake of mine that I had made. Next thing, and this is one that had been going on for a long time, was not having an accountant to help me with my taxes. So this is mistake number 12. I have been doing my taxes by myself using TurboTax, and it was a nightmare every year. I hated doing it. It took a whole day out of my weekend, and it was very stressful. I always wound up second guessing myself and wondering if I was overspending based on how much taxes I always owed. You know, Mrs. Primetime was always like, are you sure you're doing everything right? Are you sure you're doing everything right? And I said, you know, I'm doing everything right according to what TurboTax does, but I'm getting killed every year. And having an accountant really helped. It helped set me up with a plan so I wasn't getting hit with that big giant bill at the end of every year. They set me up on a quarterly plan to pay my taxes, in advance. And so it wasn't just so big of a hammer that would come down, you know, every February or March. So that's been helpful. And it's also been helpful to just, you know, have you know, just really good ideas on things that I should do for proper bookkeeping and making sure I'm keeping track of my expenses. So I have a whole playlist on my YouTube channel on bookkeeping and taxes that you could go to and check out, and you could see all sorts of tips related to that. But I highly suggest, unless you have a degree in accounting or you really, really know what you're doing with regard to taxes and accounting, that you get an accountant to help you out. It could really help protect you and also save you a lot of time and a lot of money with your reselling business. So the next one is one that I don't have an actual clip of, so I'm just going to talk about it out loud real quick. It is leaving my wallet at home when I go out to a sale somewhere. Now, fortunately, I did not make this mistake this year, but I have made it as recently as 2 years ago, where I either find myself sometimes almost halfway there and then realize I forgot my wallet. And obviously, I can't make any purchases if I don't have the wallet. And it really stinks when you're trying to get a jump on the day, you got out early, and now you find yourself heading back, and now you got to head back out. And it's just a giant waste of time, and you could be missing out, by the way, on those early deals and stuff like that. So what I suggest to prevent this, and what helped me this past year, is making sure you're doing what I would call self-inventory. So just saying to yourself the same things each time before you leave. Do I have my my phone? Check. Do I have my wallet? Check. Do I have my bag of tools? You know, check. Do I have my box or bags or whatever it is you're going to use to try to carry things around with? Do you have a food or drink? If you're going to be out for a long time, you want to take a snack. Make sure you do a check of all of those things, and also do that check before you leave a sale, because I have actually left my blue bag of tools at sales, not this year, but I left it last year 2 times, and I have acquired so many little things and helpful elements in there that if I would have permanently lost that, it really would have stunk. Fortunately, I realized quick enough, went back, and wound up getting them. But now I actually have my blue bag of tools, and if you have a little bag of tools, I highly suggest putting your name on it, your address, and your phone number where it says if lost, because someone might purchase that at an estate sale thinking they just found a little thing of tools and they like it, and now they have it and all your hard work is gone. So I averted a disaster on that a couple of times, and being really careful with making sure when you check before you leave and transition into a new spot that you have everything you need is real important. Not being in so much of a rush could really, really help you. Just make sure you're doing that self-check. So that is number 13. So number 14, and this one I'm going to go to a picture down here. And if Metal Flippin' Mel is watching this, she's going to roll her eyes probably at this one maybe. But she had suggested this to me this past weekend, which was the Creepy Christmas sale. I had gone to this the place that runs this. They have a horror show. You remember I went there recently. I got all those a couple months ago. I got all those Halloween collectibles. I got a box of comic books. I did really well. I made a good connection with a guy who I wound up buying those costumes from at a comic convention recently. So it was a great time, and I was looking forward to going this. And I put this in my phone for 12:14, just on my little notepad. And I didn't remember. So 12:14 was Saturday. I did not remember that it was actually on Saturday. I thought it was on Sunday. And so I got in my car on Sunday. I'm filming my videos. This is why I didn't have a video for you on Sunday. I'm all ready. I'm like, hey, it's Dominic. Yo, I'm ready to go out. We're going to go Creepy Christmas, all this stuff. And then I get there and it's not going on because it was the day prior. And I totally screwed up. And the way I'm going to prevent, this has happened to me a few times, even this year. The way I'm going to prevent this going forward is, you know, I used to love when I was younger, I had my own calendar, like my own wall calendar. And I have a calendar that is kind of a shared one that we use in the house with Mrs. Primetime. But I actually just bought my own calendar that I'm going to use for my business, a business calendar. It's Marvel. There's a Marvel comic character I'm going to hang it up. And I am going to plan out and put all the events that I want to go to on there so I could always see it and cross the calendar days off, so I don't make this mistake again. Because again, it's just a waste of time going out there, and I'm bummed out that I missed this because I had the wrong date. So, you know, that's just another mistake. That's actually, that mistake is very close in time to the auction mistake that I made with the mask. Those happened right around the same time. So this just goes to show you, I am not perfect, folks. There are times that I am still making errors out there and, you know, big goof ups like that one. So that one was number 14. So number 15, this is a mistake I made for a long time, which was not using white backgrounds. Now, I don't use white backgrounds for everything. Sometimes it doesn't make sense depending on the color scheme, but when you have bright colors like you have on this item, a nice white background like this really, really can help you out. Really helps the item pop and really helps sell the piece. So I use that for a lot of my items now. The program I recommend that you use for this is called PhotoFuse. I have talked about it before, PhotoFuse. So go check that out. It's a free program. It's pretty easy to use and highly suggest it. For a long time, I just was not using it. And sometimes a nice wood background can work. I like to use that for my comic books, but for items like this, I was just using a regular white board. The problem is if you use the white board, even if you brighten up the white board with like your light on your phone or through an app, it's not going to get it to that exact white that matches the natural eBay white. So there's going to be a contrast there. It's not going to look proper. So having it this way makes it a perfect blend. It makes it look very professional and it does help sell your items. So that's number 15. Number 16, and this is, I've shown you this recently, but this is missing defects on items when you are describing them. So, this is one that I made recently. I had to deal with the return. Remember, the person was upset because I had missed that there was a thin layer of tape on the side. Now, I did subsequently sell it after it was returned to me after disclosing it, but I missed it. I should have caught it. It was a black poster. Sometimes it's harder to find some things on black posters, don't stand out as well, especially things that are invisible, pieces of tape sometimes be hard to see. And I hadn't had that on my other posters from the lot before that were like a strip like this. There were little pieces here and there, but I catched them on the other ones. But this one, I just missed it and I should have caught it. I didn't. This happened once before too on when I first started getting back into reselling a few years ago more intensely. I had a picture frame and the back of it had a little bit of warping on it, on the back of it, not on the front, but on the back part, like the cardboard part on the back. And what I should have done is taken that piece of cardboard off, because if I would have done that, I would have seen that the source of that warping and the little bubbling was that not only was there some moisture exposure, which I kind of figured because there was bubbling to it, but there was actually mold inside the piece. And when the buyer got it, the buyer was upset and said, I'm surprised you would sell me something like this. And so I learned from that if you see something that looks suspicious, you need to do a little bit more investigation to figure out what's going on behind the scenes. Because if you don't do it, when your buyer gets it, you best believe that they're going to do it. And then you're going to have to either comp them or you're going to have to take a return or something like that. So making sure you're looking over your items thoroughly, and not just before you post them, but also when you're outsourcing. That's something I've done a much better job over time. But when I first started out, there are way too many instances where I would purchase things and not realize there was a defect on it. Commonly a hole in a piece of clothing, or maybe a piece was missing that I didn't realize. That's another reason, by the way, to check comps, not only to check the comps of the actual a price, but also to look. If you find a toy, for example, you might not know that there's a piece that's supposed to go to that toy that's missing, or you might not know that book is supposed to come with a slip cover. You know, these are things you will find out when you check comps. So you could tell people that if people are say something snide to you, like, oh, are you checking comps because you want to see how much it's worth? You could say, well, no, I'm not just checking that. I'm also checking to make sure that it's complete, because that's important to me and people will understand that. So, that's something to make sure you mention. So that's number 16, is not missing defects on items in terms of another mistake. Another mistake I was making up until this year was with regards to my photos. Now, these are some photos of some items that I listed recently. What I was doing, what you're seeing here is Google's, it's through Microsoft. It's called OneDrive. It's their cloud service, basically. I would highly suggest using a cloud service. It doesn't have to be Microsoft. You could do it through Amazon or just other places. You could do Dropbox, wherever. But what I was doing was taking pictures, and then the pictures I was taking on my phone, I was then sending them to myself over email and then downloading the email. And what that was doing was two things that were problematic. First of all, it was wasting time because I had to download the email. But two, it was clogging up my email. Even through Gmail, it was clogging it up such that I would have to delete like mass amounts of email. And then I was losing other important emails in the process. It was a mess. So I had to find a new system. And this is the system I highly recommend, because what happens is I take the picture and then I just press a button on my phone and it instantly puts it on my computer. So once I go right over to my computer, there it is. It's right there. I don't like listing from my phone, for people who are going to suggest that. There's not as many options available. Listing on the desktop or the laptop is what I prefer to do. I know a lot of people do as well. So if you want to do that, this is the easy way to just pretty much have it instantly transitioned over. And you could upload those pictures in bulk, and the next thing you know, they're almost instantly right there on your computer. There is no need to send anything over to your to your email and then download it from the email and clog your email up. So this is a much, much easier way. So that's number 17. Number 18, which I don't have a picture of, but let's just say, for example, it was maybe this costume, is sometimes accidentally damaging items that you have in storage because you didn't store it properly. And the area where I have made that mistake primarily in has been posters, and taking posters, taking the pictures, and then putting the poster on a shelf somewhere. And then not realizing over time, or just not taking the time to put it in within a bag and a board to protect it so that it doesn't get damaged. And then inevitably when I'm moving things around, it might actually get a tear on it. It might actually get a crease on it or something like that. And now I have to take my item down, which really stinks, because now you can't sell the piece and you had taken time to list it. So that's happened a few times. So now I've just gotten into much more of a system where as soon as I have my item listed, I make sure that I have it adequately protected so that there's no way it is going to get damaged or broken while it is in storage. So that's super important. Another one, so we are down to number 19 would be, and this is something I'm working on a lot, which is making sure that I'm not having bulk items sit around too long. So this here is a lot of 15 Dragonlance books that I had picked up at a library sale. I showed them to you recently on What Sold video. I picked them up for 10 bucks and I wound up selling them for, I believe I took like $115 on it or something like that. So it was a triple digit sale and did well with it. Problem is, I just kept them on the bottom of my bookshelf for a year and didn't list them. And that's what I'm trying to reduce now. I'm trying to make sure that when I get bulky items like this, that I make sure that I turn them around faster. So that's a work in progress. That's going to be something I'm focused a lot more on in 2020, is getting some of these bulk items that have been sitting around for too long, get them out and prevent other ones. Like you can see with those costumes, right? I had six of those costumes in those boxes. They're just sitting on a shelf. And I looked at them and I said, I cannot let them sit for a year. So I made sure I just started getting them listed. So that's important, making sure you prevent that inertia, get those items up, because they're taking up room that you could put other things on. So that leads me to number 20. And that would be, and by the way, oh, that's just the same picture. So number 20 is, I don't make this mistake anymore, but I was making this up until I'd say probably last year, is not planning a more efficient route when sourcing. And this is something you could do much easier now, especially if you're new, with apps like Yard Sale Treasure Map. You could even do it through Craigslist is going to integrate with a Yard Sale Treasure Map, or you could even just figure out in your head, you know, when you get Yard Sale Treasure Map, you could see here, it's going to put all these pinpoint geographic locations in terms of where are the sales in your area. And by doing that, by figuring out where that cluster is, let's say you have places to go to that you wrote down that aren't necessarily integrated within that app, because it's going to take the Craigslist items only and put them on there. So maybe you found something advertised in your local classified section that you want to go to. Well, write that down and then figure out, okay, wait a minute, I'm in this area right now. I need to work that sale into this flow of where I'm going. I try to like follow like a little circle in terms of where I'm going. And I will source geographically if I don't know of a particular place I want to go to that day that is just like the best place to go to. So don't get me wrong, if there's like two amazing estate sales and they're far apart, I'm going to go to those. But if if that's not available, if it's just, you know, just kind of your average run-of-the-mill day where everything seems pretty equal, I'm going to pick the best area that I know to geographically source in, and I'm just going to exhaust that area and then move on from there to the next cluster. And so that's an important thing to do. Also, make sure if you're using Yard Sale Treasure Map, this is something I started using recently too, is making sure you're making use of the color functions. So they default by showing up pink like this in terms of areas to go to. But once you go to one, you can mark it off as blue and just change the color. So now you can more easily keep track of, did I go to this one or not? These are all things to save you time, and they will make you more efficient. So that is the overview, 20 mistakes in 20 years of reselling. I'm sure that's not the end of it. I'm going to keep on going with the reselling and keep on being intense with it. And I'm sure there's going to be more mistakes I'm going to make over time. If you like this video, learning of the mistakes, I will be happy to share those with you. Of course, I would prefer not to make them, but they're going to happen. And so I do like to be transparent with you on the channel and show you that stuff as well. Nobody is perfect in reselling, folks. So anyway, if you like the video, make sure you hit the like button. Make sure you subscribe to the channel if you found it helpful. You probably watch this in bits and pieces because it's so long. I do apologize for that, but 20 years is a long time to go over. So make sure that you come to my Facebook group, the Facebook Reselling Resource Center. The link is down below in the description section, as well as to my Instagram account at @prime_time_treasure. And last bit, programming. I do have a solo live show where I'm going to talk about goal setting for 2020. And so some of the things we talked about here, I could bring up and expand upon as well. So if you have any questions for me, we're going to do some live Q&A and stuff like that. Come on by Wednesday night. That's going to be 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Hope to see you there, folks. See you at the next video. Take care.